So I'm heading to my client, Joulie. She's actually an online client, but she moved for a couple of days to Phoenix with her dog to help her family member. And so I have the awesome opportunity to meet those guys. So let's see what's going on there.
So this is Hayley, and she,
hi, Hayley.
She tends to be the quiet one of my two, the quieter.
Good. And the other ones are two here? Only one,
yeah,
right?
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Good. How about you be gentle? Being cute doesn't help you anything.
What's that cool little thing you got?
That's a GoPro camera, so I can record our sessions and we can talk about that later. So he has a certain way to want things.
Yeah.
So she's polite and she gets paid. Well, he has to just look what's going on here. It's like, what the heck? I'm just cute. Why don't I get things?
Why don't I get something? I'm cute enough.
Okay, so instead of jumping, I'm rewarding him for sitting whenever he gets that.
He may never.
Oh, yeah, he will. There you go. Good. There you go. And she gets on and so on. You see how quick it goes?
The thing I was asking, when you do this, what's that doing?
I'll show you that again, so you can watch that.
Okay.
So now we have two dogs sitting politely because she knows that that's how we get it. And so I have to be very accurate with how I reward them, because I reward them for their mindset, not only for the body language.
And I've been working with her on this.
Perfect. She's doing great.
She's doing good.
Now what I want to do is I want him to give me more space. So I'm not giving any reward. I want him to move.
You want him to move?
Yeah. But I'm not telling him that. He will figure it out. I want him basically to surrender those treats. So I'm looking for any body language that I get that tells me that, okay, whenever you're ready. Well, she gets a treat for that. See how she changed?
Mm-hmm.
Now we'll wait for him. From that, what do I get in exchange?
You're asking for what do you get in exchange?
Yeah, that's how emotional conversation is going on. He wants that, and I want him to offer something. And so he has to figure out was it worth it?
What does it take to get it? How much do I want to do? Both these dogs are good and hungry. He hasn't been eating well.
Mm-hmm.
He ate this morning. She, like I said, she hasn't eaten. She's a good eater. But they have a raw, homemade raw diet, and now I'm trying to pawn off stuff that's prepackaged.
Mm-hmm.
And goes so well.
So he's pulling off his repertoire and he's like, how do I get it else? Jumping didn't work, sit doesn't work. So let's see if he can copy that. Some dogs learn from other dogs' performance.
Yeah, I can see that.
There you go.
Any kind of movement.
Anything. Anything that tells me, okay, I'll give it up. Scratching in that case was kind of a message, like, yeah, I'm doing my other stuff, because he didn't want to admit that.
Nice.
The next thing I can take is him checking in on me in person, not staring at my treats.
The walking with her, mm-hmm. and the was going. She's not a puller. She's not a lunger. It's
there
going real well. Real well. My husband's supposed to be working with my other one at home. We've had huge rainstorms.
Mm-hmm.
So he promised me he'd go out there today.
So every time he breaks what he promised, I'm just pulling away from it. Good. He checked in on... Whoa, dude. So see, I didn't complete my action.
Because he gave up his
Correct.
Seated. Yeah. And Haley's like, come on.
So next time he checks in on me, he gets another treat.
He's staring at your hand.
So I can do it more extreme, having my hands all over the place.
And you want to look at you.
Right. Because he doesn't get the whole picture, just break it down in small pieces. Good. Nice. That was nice. Okay, let's try again. So that's the half of the 2-treat exercise. That's the half of the 2-treat exercise.
Two-treat exercise.
Yeah, that's half of it. Like, you know, you want that? How do you get it? By giving it up and checking on me.
Me. You're bringing it to me. That's right.
Good.
I couldn't remember that. That's right.
Three rewards. The one is checking on me, she gets both treats, plus a petting, plus emotions. Good. Good job. Yeah. Let's try again. Let's try with him, because he's a difference. Good job. Smart thinking. You know that in the job, he did it already before. See how his movements were more mechanic? And she was like more smooth in her movements. She's more confident than he is. So doing that exercise, you can also do some small assessments.
I think that's the two of mine with the dog too. She seems like she's the aggressor, but she's not confident at all.
Right. So every time she wants to treat, I have the right to deny it. So denying you, just pull my hand away. You see how immediately she reacts? And now I want to change the attitude of going away from my hand and sitting in front of me. You see the change?
Well, you're looking forward to look at you.
Yeah. Because again, you don't reward just the body language, you also reward emotions. Now what we're looking for is for the emotional alignment, how her intentions are. The intention is going to the tree means she's aligned with the tree. If she wants it from me, she will be aligned with me. Some dogs had a hard time switching completely over from I want it into give it up. Because from that brain trait, they need to keep going, right? So we kind of have to switch around. If you really want it, you cannot get it if you're aligned with this. You have to align with me. And once you align with me, then I want you to pay attention to me. And if you pay attention to me, now I want you to give it up. And if you don't give it up, then you will get both of it. So I have two dogs, so now I have to deliver simultaneously because every dog who hears the word look has to get a treat. So I say look, and both dogs get a treat.
You start with the first one, then step two, now you say look.
Okay? Now because I have established that I can solve complex problems, now I can go there and start getting attention. Look. And so what we trigger right now is them to memorize that every time I say the word look, they will get something.
If they do look. Oh, that just gets
right. They just get something.
But they're already doing, they're already right here.
What I reward is the attention. Look. And so right now I program the attention. If I say look, you get a treat. If I say look, you get a treat. If I say look, you get a treat. What if you're not near me? Then you look for me. That's what exercise is for. Look.
if you're over there, and says, look. Right. And then we'll turn around and it's like, wait, what is what I get? Come over here, come get it. Look. Now, when I make, for example, the noise, I'm going to see what's going to happen next. Look. Good job. I got the attention back. Because I promised, if I say, look, you get something. So come back here. Look right there. Can you see how he attacked me? Let's push it again.
What's that?
That he gets so excited about that that he wants to grab it before somebody else does, the one who knocked at the door.
He does that when you go to the door.
Right. He starts connecting.
It hits your hand.
Good job. Nice. Good job. So what we're going to do for that is we're going to desensitize that part. Seated. Okay, how good that goes? Did I force the dog? No. Did I punish him? No. Did I say no, but dog? Good. Look. Come. Sit. Good job. So look is pay attention, come is the job, sit is the job. So I task, and now all of this together is what do I do when the door knocks? How we move things around. First of all, I have to establish a relationship. Who am I to tell you what to do? Well, if I can solve the complex problems, you can trust me, right? And now you can trust me calling you back, right? You can trust me to give that up if I tell you to give it up. You get paid for it. So the dog is a job for him. He goes to protect the job. But who am I to call him out? I haven't established my relationship yet. Now I have. Look. Make sense?
Yeah.
And their job is to be protected. So I cannot blame them for doing the job. But I can modify the job into a better job. For example, I want you to protect me, but not that. How about you come over here and now? And the next job would be, if that happens, I want you to go back to your bed and lay down. Only then I will open the door, and only then you will see what's behind the door. Look! Good.
You have to be in your bed, and then you have to...
Correct. If you see them, then you can only come over if I ask you to. Because I secured that. In this way, I take away his job. I give you another one. While I'm doing my job, you want you to do your job. So you cannot blame a dog for doing his job, and punishing him or even reprimanding him for doing the job, and not give him a counter job, so he can still do the job. Is that the job? Yeah, it's the job. Come. Sit. Touch. Good. Good. Come. Sit. Touch. Good job. You guys are so cute. You guys are friends. There you go. So what's the other problem?
The introduction of dogs, you know, the different personalities, I my daughter's a white woman, she wants to play with my son, I think she's just, it's not what she does.
Mm-hmm.
She's not a playful dog.
But here's what's happened. You have a male, you have a female. Where did you get them from?
Where did I get
them? Yeah, what's the story?
She's from a breeder.
Okay. Okay, so she was a breeding dog.
She was a breeding. Well, no, she was a breeding.
Oh, she was a puppy.
She was a puppy.
Okay.
A breeder of lots, and she had two litters.
Okay.
Of which this one came from one litter, was born on the same day.
Okay.
And my other female was born on the same day, the second litter. So she stayed with them.
Mm-hmm.
Stayed with the breeder until they came in.
Good. So
this one's a rescue.
What's her experience? trigger. So if the male dog is excited around her, she will be triggered to resist and to go into a mode, like,
Okay, right? Good.
And so it's in her body memory, in this DNA, to go into alert mode if something excited is around her. So you can desensitize it, but you cannot shut it off. It will always be there, to be startled if something gets up too much. It's like another person, kids swimming around. They don't feel in control, they kind of get scared about it. And so if he's to push it because he wants to play, and obviously he doesn't have these social skills, he will not recognize her message, like, leave me alone, or I don't want to play right now. And she has to correct him for that.
And what she did, he was running outside.
Right.
And had fun. And when she came rolling around, he tried to include her, and she snapped at him.
Right.
And that's the proper thing to do.
Well, there's a balance between what I tolerate to happen around my environment. It's none of my business if it doesn't connect to me. And he is too excited about it. So we have two things to go on. Him spinning around like crazy because he wants to get his energy out, he doesn't have another outlet, and she has to either give it to you so you can take care of that, and if you don't, then she gets involved if she is immediately, you know, connected to that. Maybe the dog invites you to play and she doesn't want, and he still pushes it.
Yeah, but she doesn't want snapping, is not something that
she could walk away. That's an option. Something dogs don't know really, because they feel entitled to react to the problem and solve the problem. If they cannot, then they get forced about it. But you know what? We can walk away from stuff. It's okay to walk away. So if the door rings and you think that's your job, I can call you off, because that's the job too. So there's nothing wrong with giving up. Let me go. And so that routine exercise includes that as well. So it's kind of like a very interesting multi-dimensional exercise where the dog is teaching to make ethical and moral decisions. The moral is you cannot just take it because you want it, but you can show me your intentions, and if I think it's appropriate, I'm going to share it with you. But you cannot push me in its face. And so what do you do when you really, really want something bad? You sit and wait. But we'll kill it together, but not now. Anyway. Because dogs from the nature avoid conflict, but if there is no other solution, they are forced to deal with it the way they think it's appropriate. And some dogs don't know it's appropriate. They go overkill.
If I had to describe these two, I'd say this one's sort of reserved.
Mm-hmm.
You know what you want. And Roscoe is over friendly.
Mm-hmm. Well, this over-friendly that he shows is basically trying to control the situation because of his insecurities.
Would you make sense of the rest of it?
Right. Because he doesn't know exactly the job description, therefore he's kind of overreacting.
So their job with him would be to be real clear with their kid's job description.
Right.
Because
right
that?
Now we just let things happen and let him deal with it, and if he fails, then we get upset about it. Like, we jump off the plane, we try to find a parachute. Oops, I don't have one. What do we do now? Oh, you shouldn't. You always should take a parachute with you. But the protocol is, before you get in the plane, you should check your parachute. Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah, because nobody told you that.
Well, so they want to work with this stuff, that's their goal. They
right.
Understand what this
individual, breaking down the job description. What do I expect the dog to do? What's going to happen if the door knocks? Come here. Come.
You want me to move?
No, it's fine. No. Come. No, you're not this dog. You see her body also, how she reacts?
What is that saying?
Her whole body moves.
Oh, yeah, it does.
Right?
Any tips for how to make this trip home? I've come to the conclusion that my dog shouldn't be on a plane, I'm going to drive.
Well, you know, there's a lot of things going on in the plane.
Oh.
First of all, we have the stress of the environment being in the kennel, and then you have the altitude, and you have the pressure. So dog pressure, that kind of, they're not short period of time.
So I had her out on my feet, just clinging. Should I put her in a crate?
I would say put her in a crate, and maybe give her some calming remedies, kind of like into like, la la la. Okay, because she just cannot handle it. Crate, you can create a partition and have a right and a left side, and each one has a separate crate.
And there again.
And the other thing you can do is you can put things on top of the crate, so you're not losing a lot of room in your car. You can stop it up. You can even more room than the crate.
Mm-hmm.
You can use a box crate, like an air crate in a small size. You should have two small air crates in there, and you can have both separately. Enough space with the water in there, then that would be great.
She likes to be up on the seat, not look out.
Mm-hmm.
And the other one likes to be down on the floor.
Okay, because he likes to be cooler down there.
And she's a hot tub.
Yeah.
She's on top.
Yeah. So what you can do is you can move the chair backwards, put one crate down, or create that as a whole place for you to be, right? Make him a nice cozy bed,
mm-hmm.
and have her being on top in the bed. But they have to be
locked in. They're always locked in.
Yeah. Because the problem is the airbag.
Oh, well, they don't stay in front, so they're behind me.
Oh, that's cool then.
But one, they're behind me, and one's up, one's down, and they're always buckled in.
Right.
They're always in their harnesses and buckled in. We did it last year. We came, but then it was not easy.
Thank you. Oh, I get a kiss. Oh, thank you. I love you too. You see how he cut her off?
Mm-hmm.
There we go. So I will walk it off next time. Good. You're such a good girl, right? Yeah, you know. That's what you do.
Okay.
So playtime. We don't want him to use her as a toy or as a tool. But you know, he needs some extra exercise because he gets stressed on having so many people in here. So maybe take him out for a walk in the morning and give him a good run. And then he passed out for the day. He's like, you guys do whatever you guys want, I'll rest.
Yeah. They try to knock him out in the morning and do a long walk at night too. He's got some crazy schedules here.
Mm-hmm.
So,
And then, you know, you guys moved in here and, you know, he doesn't have this regulation.
Well, and this is a new home, right?
Yeah.
10 days.
Yeah. Oh, he's super new. Oh, well, that makes sense.
It's all new to everybody.
Right, right,
you know, all this commotion and the people
yeah.
and the coming and going and the building. And it's just crazy.
Yeah, so it's a 10 days rescue.
And that, no. He was with them in their other apartment.
That makes sense.
He was with about 3 homes though during the rescue. Then he was with them and everything was fine. And 10 days till they all moved in here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for him it's a big change. And he doesn't know what's happening. So he tries to establish himself a job. I just did a video like you with that. You know, he's a working dog as well. And it's a job. Protecting the door. And it's all these invasions of people coming
and
in, the dogs coming in.
It's all new.
Yeah, yeah. So that can backfire. So being protected and start nipping at people because of the move. Because you didn't control that.
She does that a little bit with big men with big feet.
Mm-hmm.
They come in and they move back.
Yeah.
They got with their feet.
Yeah. Well, he wants to control it. Don't move out of my control. Sometimes there is a consent form of people picking the dog up, and so her body goes into like, "Don't move, you're gonna pick me up," and so don't move.
So when somebody comes into my home, lives like that,
she should not judge it.
But I have to stay. Oh, okay.
Take her away from that judgment over there. Door entrance is where she's like, oh, let me tell you who you are. I don't like you. I'm like, dude, who are you to tell him what to do? He's my friend, so how about you back off and mind your business? Oh, I thought it was my business. No, it's not. Your business is stay in your bed, and I'll call you when I need you. So if you want to stay in a family, that's how it runs. So we give up our parenting power, and the dog starts parenting us, making the judgment who we need and who we not. Come here. Good. It's none of your business what's going on there. No growling. How about you sit? Good. And you only say it once. But if you have to step into your parenting power, and you cannot trust yourself saying, like, yeah, I called you right now, and where are you? I don't see any dog. Oh, here you are. Good job.
Okay.
Make sense?
Yeah, it does. How would you suggest we proceed with the rest of our training back, of course, back to Skype,
mm-hmm.
but timing, should I work with them until I come here? What do you...
No, we'll continue doing our work as we always do.
Okay.
It just, don't rely on me doing things.
No.
I want you to understand it and practice it. And you learn, you would learn more trying it yourself than watching me doing it. Because that's easy, I can do that. Now, how would you do that? I don't know. And so you go with trial and error, and you improve yourself every time you do your exercise. And then you also see the improvements, and your dog doesn't have an in-between person doing it for you. So you kind of have to swim.
Right. So timing-wise, we go home next Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
So have a chance to practice some here, but home to another 10 days, 2 weeks.
I would say when you go home, just do another session because she will forget what she did in the home and now she has to reestablish herself in the home. How long will you stay here?
Just a week.
Oh, okay. So basic things you can do for a walk, let's go through that process. That's easy. No, we'll do it in here. So first of all, you teach her to come. So you move backwards. And as she does that, that you go come. And for arriving, she gets a treat. So you name what she does. You don't ask her to do it. Make sense?
Yeah, and we were working on that, and you were commenting about not pulling the leash, I understand. But sometimes like that they have to be pulled to me.
That's what I'm trying to explain to you. Don't pull. Let her do the job.
Okay.
Okay? So you go backwards and she does that which you call come. She has to come to you. Her wanting to come to you is what you call come. Come? Good. Now once you understand that when you're moving backwards, she has to come to you, which you call come. Now I can use that and say, let's go. And walk with her next to me.
And if she doesn't come, I don't keep walking, I just stop until she does.
Let's build it up a little bit. Okay, again, she comes to me, and then we say, let's go, and then she gets a treat for walking next to me. Okay? So go like that. Come. Let's go. Good. Meaning if you're going in the same direction, do the same thing.
It's paying attention to you.
Right. And now we're talking business. Let's go. Good. Do I use a leash? No, but she learns now, let's go, means you're walking next to me and paying attention. Let's go. Good. Let's go. Good job. Okay? Now, to the next level, you just add the leash. If she moves forward on her own, you're doing nothing, you just stay there. And as soon as she turns back to you, asking you, like, what's going on? And you're like, you know what, how about you come back and get her a treat? And when she comes back to you, you say, let's go. And you go in the other direction. The reason why I changed directions is because you were so far away from me, now I've changed my mind, I go over there. Because you cannot predict where I'm going, so why are you going ahead? And I'm not telling her that she's bad, but she recognizes that if she goes ahead of me, she's missing my point. She doesn't know where I'm going. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So you have two options. The one is to yank her which makes you look bad, or not yanking her and make her look bad for not performing the job you expected to do. And so you can start walking around in the house and then you call it God. And then she gets rewarded for it. And that routine, let's go, means following you? Yes. So if I'm going outside with the leash and I say let's go, you're supposed to follow me. Let's go. Good. And then so on. And now you can expand that. And then you can run and stop. And now she knows, in the mode of let's go, which is the job, I have to pay attention and remove and add to and remove my speed according to what is around me. So I have to pay attention to the person I'm working with because that's the job. So if I move, she moves, and if I stop, she stops. And now I'm describing the job, which I mean let's go.
Job and let's go.
Right. Some people call it heel, but heel is something very, very specific. It's like walking like that. I don't want that. I want to go for a walk. I want you to pay attention. I don't care where exactly you are in my space, but not too far ahead, not too far back. Just pay attention to where I am. And if I stop, you stop. If I move, you move.
And the only time she really should go off is when she's indicating she needs to go.
I still will release her to go.
You have to release her.
Because let's go gives you a certain freedom to move in an area of 6 feet, which is the length of the leash.
But I mean, so she's paying attention to me,
right,
in that area, then she'll start to pull to say, and I know that means I have to go by you.
Well, no. I don't like her to tell me by pulling on the leash that she wants something.
How does she let me know she needs to?
Well, you're supposed to know, you're the parent. So what you do is you start creating pause. Do you expect the baby to cry like crazy, to pull over and let him go to the bathroom? Right? You know that every 2 hours he needs to go to the bathroom, period. So we leave from point A, we go to point B, and at point B we're going to pee. Until then, you have to hold on. I guarantee you for the next 6 hours, she doesn't need to pee again. She can mark, but you don't want her to mark.
He does that.
Yeah, that's normal.
She doesn't.
If he's insecure, he will start marking in the house.
And you know what? That's very interesting you say that. My daughter said, Russell's starting to have an accident. That's
yeah,
a new house.
He has accidents.
To mark his face.
Right. He marks his face because he feels insecure, but if he does mark his face, somebody comes and takes it like the other one happened.
You're right.
Right?
Took the other one away.
See? Good. So dogs mark because they want to secure their space. They're stressed and they're fearful of losing their space, they're going to mark it so that everybody knows it's their space and nobody takes it away. So marking is not kind of sign of dominance, it's a sign of insecurity that if I don't mark it, you're going to lose it. Make sense?
It does.
So punishing a dog for feeling that way is really not good, because I see some people pushing the dog's nose.
Yeah, no.
What happened? Well, why are you pissed like that? You the lady with this sticky stuff on her face? Oh, there you go. Look. So a good way to stop that insecurity is to start creating structure day one. 6:05 breakfast. 6:10 potty. 6:15 back in your crate. 12:30 potty, watering, and so start creating a routine so you can rely on that. Once I'm in a crate, I have no business under the rest. And I'm looking forward to get out that job next time.
So your crate is your rest time.
Right. But in the crate, you cannot have an accident because this is clean space. And so now you will learn that in the crate is a clean space, and outside of that space is a dirty space. Because that will be kind of a gray zone. For him, outside of his crate, he can be wherever he wants, right? It's like everywhere, like everywhere he can be, then it's not his bed. And so in that house, you say, from your bed, we're going outside, and outside you can do whatever you want, I'll pay for it. And in here, there's no need to be because you can do it on the outside. So you start introducing what's the meaning of outside and what's the meaning of inside. In my house is your bed, which is your inside. But my house is also your inside. So don't pee inside. Outside. Inside, outside. Clean, dirty. If it makes an accident, it happens. skip the whole thing, don't make any drama. See why peed. A, because you missed that he drank water and now he missed nearly an hour.
Your lack of time.
Right?
Yeah.
Or he has a UTI because it's bad, so she can clean that. So take a sample to the vet and ensure that he doesn't have an infection. And then go back to training. Crate training, potty training, all over again. Because it's a new space, yes, we're establishing something new from the beginning.
When I first got these girls, the other one had more, a little more trouble, but it was explained to me that they're having accidents in a space, a room or wherever, giving them too much room for that, for their development. They need small, a crate,
right.
Even a half of a crate.
Well, the idea is, not because he has too much room, it's because he naturally will divide that space in a clean little
space. And I'm
going
to go way over there and do my accident, because I'm going to stay.
I have a dog, he'll only pee and poop in the bushes. He doesn't have a push, he eventually poop on the stone, like on top of it, like you make like an ice cream cone.
He kind of does that.
Yeah.
And she likes to go, we used to live on a pit property that had a little further out. She has to go as far out as she can get.
Yeah, because she'll eventually be afraid of people being next to her when she does it.
Right, and she, I found out she's marking, you know, this is my, you know, everybody needs to know. I don't want to keep them too close to my people.
Look at you, you're like a goddess.
A goddess that doesn't eat.
Well, she can eat for a couple of days now. She will not starve. We have some leftovers, right? So what you do is you just recreate the position she used to eat when she was at home. The direction, like in the right corner next to the refrigerator.
The closet and the crate.
Right, so recreate that. If she's used to eating in a crate, then feed her in a crate. You don't have a crate? Get a box, cut it out, make that a crate. So maybe she has one reference point.
Okay.
And for her, that's something big, there's no reference point.
And it's scary to eat,
yeah,
you take your mind off.
Are kind of like, they like to have the routines. So it's kind of like you're sleeping on the wrong side of the bed. You just cannot sleep because you don't like that side.
Right.
So she doesn't have her two bowls next to each other because some girls are OCD, some dogs are OCD, and they want things to be that way, not this way. And if there's something in the bowl, I don't like it, you know? It's not what I expected to get. What's my chicken? I smell chicken. Why don't I get the chicken? Where's my chicken? And like, I don't need that. And so dogs have expectations. If they smell and you have a pizza, they want a piece of it. That's what we do, right? We eat. So why does it smell fish? I want pizza.
Alright, I'll try to recreate a space that's like... Well, you know, I think part of it too is separation from her.
Where's your other piece? No, the other one is just a small teeth. Oh, what is cute.
I think she misses her buddy.
Yeah, right.
She eats next to.
Yeah, she also feels responsible for her buddy.
Right,
yeah,
I'm sort of in charge of that.
Yeah, and this is not my buddy.
This is somebody that, you know.
She doesn't understand that the other one's left.
Right. And she used to be the initiator of play with my other one. Mm-hmm. Basically just leave me alone. And so she's not initiating at all.
Yeah, I'm so happy to meet her.
Yeah, I look forward to you meeting Layla too.
You know, I've been only so far maybe 5 online clients.
Oh.
Yeah, because I'm all over the place.
Well, you know, it's kind of a coincidence. Well, isn't that fun? It's just coincidence. I was over at Park Avenue trying to figure out which Peter. When I come back down, I make their food and I'll do that again for a reason. But I went over there, I told them I met you. But that's how I met you, is because I went in there and my daughter set up with when she got
right,
in
right,
a better
right.
source of food. And that Rick,
right.
Nice guy,
mm-hmm.
He gave me Dr. Ford's name,
mm-hmm.
Pamela Ford, Ford's Gazette. He gave us the name of Rumor.
Mm-hmm.
And my daughter's been, you know, doing all that, and so then I get their emails, and your name popped up on there, and it's like, well, that sounds interesting, and then luck would have it, I'm down here, so.
Okay, super.
All right.
Yeah, right.
Thank you.
You coming home? Okay. Yeah, let me tell you. So consent with small dogs is super important. I see all these people like, oh, that's my dog, and just lift him up and go with him.
I'm real careful. He said, can I pet your dog? I said, you need to let my dog smell you, and you let my dog decide if you can pet her, because I don't know. They go down with their hand.
They don't see that that is actually an aggressive action.
Right. If they just stand there, she'll come up to you if she wants, and if she does, then you can pet her.
So what I do usually is I let them come over, and if they want to be lifted, they come and sit on my hand.
Yeah, she's not a lifting dog.
Okay.
She's not.
She's not. Sorry, I tolerate that. Yeah. Just because I want it doesn't mean she can have it. Right?
She's not a lot of
dogs. I worked with another dog a couple of weeks ago, and every time the hand would approach, she would shake like that. And she says, guys, stop moving her around. And I saw in my hand, like, oh, let me show you my dog. And she said, what are you doing? And that's what we try to heal right now. Oh, I wasn't aware I'm doing that. And guess what happened next? All of a sudden, another dog comes to them and wants to get petted. Because he recognized that they respect the space. And no, there's no shaking anymore.
Basically, the dog,
an hour.
Dog came to them.
Yeah.
So what I do with her, is I'll go sit on the couch, and if she wants to come next to me, she'll come lay her head on my lap.
Yeah,
on my lap.
Yeah, you
go.
You see the migration? Yeah.
Pretty fun, wasn't it?
Yeah, right? Good. Other questions?
No, I think not. Do you send me a copy of this?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, great. Cool little camera.
Yeah. My good baby.
Yeah, send me the invoice for the